Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Ali Reza Fahad, and in this lecture I will discuss aspects of the novel by E.M. Forster. This is E.M. Forster. Edward Morgan Forster was born in London in 1879. He was an English novelist, short story writer, essayist, and librettist. Forster's father died early and he was brought up by his mother and his great aunt. Forster attended King's College, Cambridge and became a member of a discussion society known as the Apostles at King's College between 1897 and 1901. After leaving the university, he traveled with his mother to Greece and Italy. Forster became a writer shortly after graduating from King's College. He was a part of the Bloomsbury Group, a set of unconventional British Bohemian thinkers like Virginia Woolf and Lytton Strachey. Forster spent 3 wartime years in Alexandria, Egypt, doing civilian work and visited India twice. His main works are novels like Where Angels Fear to Tread, The Longest Journey, A Room with a View, Howards End, A Passage to India, and Morice. Whereas his essays include aspects of the novel, The Abinger Pageant, Abinger Harvest, 2 Cheers for Democracy, What I Believe, and other essays. In the 1930s and 1940s, Forster became a successful broadcaster on BBC Radio. Forster established his reputation as a liberal thinker and strong advocate of democracy. He declined a knighthood in 1949 and was made a Companion of Honor in 1953. In 1969, he was made a member of the Order of Merit by Queen Elizabeth II. Forster died of a stroke in Coventry in 7th June 1970 at the Buckingham's home. Aspects of the novel. Aspects of the novel is the publication of a series of lectures on the English language novel delivered by E.M. Forster at Cambridge in 1927. This book is a treatise on writing and literary criticism. Forster communicates his information in a simple, easy-to-understand manner and derides the pseudo-scholarship of traditional literary criticism. He defines a novel simply as any fictitious prose work over 50,000 words, while English literature is any work written in the English language, rather than those only from a specific country or location. Forster dismisses the method of examining the novel as a historical development, in preference to an image of all the greatest novelists throughout time are sitting together in a circle writing their books simultaneously. Forster compares the form and texture of the novel to those of a symphony. As for the subject, he expects the work to reveal the hidden life at its source. Human nature, he concludes, is the novelist's necessary preoccupation. He employs the term aspects because its vague, unscientific nature suits what he calls a spongy form in question. The 7 aspects offered for discussion are the story, the people or characters, plot, fantasy, prophecy, pattern, and the rhythm. Now I will discuss all of these aspects in detail. First, we will discuss the story. A story is a narrative of events arranged in their time sequence. It simply tells us what happened and in what order. It is a primitive feature. At its most basic, the novel is a story, or tells a story. This is the backbone of the novel. It goes back to the beginning of storytelling, where one thing happens after the other. The story should be founded on the question, what happens next? It must invoke suspense in the reader. There is a universal curiosity to know what happens next. Therefore, a successful story is one that keeps the audience guessing and engaged. Like in the Arabian Nights, Shahrazad saves her life, her own life, because she keeps the king wanting to know what happens next. A good story, however, must add value. By value, Foster means the most intense occurrences or the greater experiences of one's life. Value has no role in a story which is concerned with the life in the time rather than the life by values, meaning no event is more important than another. The Antiquary by Sir Walter Scott is indeed founded on the what happens next question, but it lacks value. In contrast, War and Peace by Leo Tolstoy is a good example of a sequence of events that unfolds over the time while adding value. The basis of a novel is a story, but storytelling alone can never produce a great novel. Next, we will discuss the second aspect of novel as described by Foster, which is characters or people. Characters are needed to explore the value of human experiences. Foster compares experiences of real people, whom he calls Homo sapiens, to the experiences of characters in novels, whom he calls Homo fictus. The characters in stories are not real people, rather they are like real people. Sometimes they, Homo fictus, seem more real than the actual people, Homo sapiens. An author accomplishes this by revealing the character's hidden inner life. If a character is fully known, the novel gives the feeling that the author knows the character fully. Foster believes the technique of telling stories from different viewpoints is not as important as having the reader accept what the writer says and having a proper mixture of characters. Fictional characters tend to be more sensitive than people in real life. Love is usually overrepresented, and other basic facts of life like birth, food, sleep, and death don't take up much space in stories as in the real life. Foster distinguishes between flat characters and round characters. Flat characters are types or caricatures. They can be summed up in a single phrase. Flat characters having one or two defining characteristics are easily recognized when first introduced and easily remembered afterwards. This appeals to our yearning for permanence. Flat characters are good when comic but boring when tragic or serious. Round characters, on the other hand, have further dimensions than first shown to their personality, which are revealed by events that demand them. They are likely to influence the development of the story. Round characters are capable of surprising us in a convincing way. According to Foster, nearly all Dickens' characters are flat, yet his stories nevertheless manage to paint a vision of humanity that is not shallow. Whereas Jane Austen focuses her stories on round characters, and although she usually ends her novels before they have had a chance to live out their lives, the reader has no difficulty in imagining them doing so. Next aspect is the plot. A plot is a narrative of events that focuses on causality. Foster's famous quotation, "The king died and then the queen died," is a story. "The king died and then the queen died of grief" is a plot, is based on the idea that plot is controlled by causality. If it is a story, we ask and then. If it is a plot, we ask why. Plot demands intelligence and memory from reader to connect threads, which allows the author to create mystery by delaying certain explanations until later in the plot. Mystery is essential to the plot and cannot be appreciated without intelligence. This relationship between cause and effect also connects the characters with the plot. However, plot must be a balance between events and characters. A balance between people and events is difficult to achieve because characters ought to be predictable, but a plot ought to cause surprise. If plots are heavily structured at the expense of the characters or drawn to fit the pre-arranged measure of the plot, they will lack a life of their own, like of Thomas Hardy's. Nearly all novels are feeble at the end because the dictates of plot require a resolution which the novelist write at the expense of the characters. He adds that death and marriage are the most convenient resources of the novelist in formulating an ending. Fantasy. Fantasy is introduced into a novel to produce a special effect. Fantasy implies a supernatural, but it may do this by no more than simply hinting through a magical quality in events. Fantasy is a genre that makes an additional demand on the reader. The novelist asks his readers to first accept the world of his book and then accept the fantastic. Some of the common devices of fantasy are like introduction of a god, ghost, angel, or monkey. Monster, midget, witch into ordinary life. Its suggestions and absence are what classify the book as fantasy. Like Tristram Shandy, where nothing fantastic happens but the world represented would allow the furniture to begin talking without much surprise. He also discusses parody and adaptation of earlier works, which allow a story to be layered upon by many authors' imaginations. This helps authors who have trouble creating characters, rather new characters. Prophecy. Prophecy in a novel as a tone of voice of the author, a song by which his theme is the universe, although his subject matter may be anything but universal. Prophecy is an ancient author's voice with a universal theme. The characters are more just than characters. It demands humility and the absence of a sense of humor. Dostoevsky, whose characters always represent something more than themselves. Unlike symbolism, which has concrete meanings, the meanings of prophecy are more imprecise yet unfailingly universal, which connect us with the history of humankind. Prophecy is the ordinary world of fiction, but reaches back into the universal. Pattern. Pattern is an aesthetic aspect of the novel. A novel has a pattern when it has a geometric shape. Geometric shapes such as an hourglass, where one character's social claim intersects with another character's social fall. There may be another shape, like circular shape, where a character ends up back where they started. Pattern may be nourished by anything in the novel, any character, scene, word, but it draws most of its nourishment or motivation from the plot. The problem of pattern in novels is that it shuts the door on life, as the characters are made secondary to the pattern here. Pattern is the only thing that adds an aesthetic quality of beauty to a novel. Pattern is aesthetic and allows a reader to see the book as a whole. When characters are forced into a pattern, instead of allowing the plot to grow organically, the plot loses authenticity, richness of life-like characters. The verdict is often ब्यूटिफुली डन बट नॉट वर्थ डूइंग. रिदम इज द लास्ट एस्पेक्ट दैट वॉज डिस्कस्ड एंड प्रोपाउंडेड बाय फॉस्टर. रिदम इज सिमिलर टू अ म्यूजिकल मोटिव विच रिकर्स विद स्लाइट वेरिएशंस, रेपिटिशन प्लस वेरिएशन थ्रू आउट द स्टोरी एंड सर्व्स टू हेल्प यूनिफाई इट. रिदम हैज़ अ लाइफ ऑफ इट्स ओन. इट स्टिचेज द बुक टूगेदर फ्रॉम द इनसाइड व्हेन द प्लॉट इज नॉट द फोकस. प्राउस्ट हैज़ म्यूजिकल फ्रेजेज दैट रेकर और रीअकर थ्रू आउट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ रिमेंबरेंस ऑफ थिंग्स पास्ट. देर इज नॉट मच प्लॉट टू द बुक बट प्राउस्ट रिदम, हिज अटेंशन टू डिटेल एंड रेकरिंग मोटिव्स आर वट टाई इट टूगेदर. It is doubted rhythm can be achieved by writers who plan books beforehand. Foster concludes that rhythm in the novel provides a more open-ended narrative structure without sacrificing characters. Finally, Foster concludes that development of the novel is no more than the development of humanity. Thank you very much.